trusted Christ and he saved you. Think on that as we sing this song.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. You called my name. Citizen of heaven, when I was broken, you are my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open, 'cause when you call my name, I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glory.
For the Lord God. Like when I walk by your your side, I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine.
Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine.
I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever worship you.
I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? I dance for it, Jesus. For in all of you be still, will I stand in your presence?
To my knees will I fall, will I sing hallelujah?
Will I be able to speak it all?
I can only imagine, yeah. I can only
7.6 billion. Now that's a big number. That's how many people there are on Earth. In the U.S. alone, estimates say that out of 328 million, there are nearly 246 million lost souls, men, women, boys, and girls that don't know Jesus. Those numbers seem big, but what if we were to focus on the number one? The Bible tells us that heaven rejoices every time one person comes to know Jesus. What if we were to focus on the daily conversations, those everyday meaningful interactions for Christ that can truly make an eternal difference in someone's life? We can reach our nation with the gospel. We can reach the millions. we can reach our friends and family and neighbors by starting with one. Who's your one?
Who's your one? That's our emphasis all month. In August, you'll see those Who's Your One towers all out in the foyer. Take one of those pens, write your name and the one's name that you're going after. Your name, my one is, and we're praying over all of those names. It takes courage to go after one. I had someone email me, text me last night, said, Pastor, my one's coming tomorrow. I was not surprised that the one was coming. What surprised me and encouraged me and thrilled me is that I had never heard that individual talk to me about evangelism before. They had never said, I got a burden for someone, but they had found courage to make the ask for someone to come. You need to take courage and make the ask. Who's your one? All month long, we're doing it in small groups, we're teaching, and we're getting fired up to go after one at a time. Dr. Hunt leads that for us in the North American Mission Board. He'll be here in October preaching for us on a Sunday night, and you'll want to be here for that, and also you'll want to be back here tonight. This choir is going to fill this loft. Veritas will be right here with us, and if the tenor comes and puts his jacket in the offering plate, I'm going to alter it and wear it next Sunday. Amen. I like that jacket. And we'll be right here with these gentlemen tonight. Good to have you back at a place called Olive. Take your Bible and go to Joshua chapter 1 this morning as I share a message again about courage. Courage for a new start. Courage to begin again. Joshua chapter 1, verse 1 through verse 9. The Word of God says, Now it came about after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, that the Lord spoke to Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' servant, saying, this is what the Lord said, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore arise, cross this Jordan, you and all this people, to the land which I am giving to them, to the sons of Israel. Every place on which the sole of your foot treads, I have given it to you, just as I spoke to Moses, from the wilderness and this Lebanon, even as far as the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, as far as the great sea toward the setting of the sun, will be your territory. No man will be able to stand before you all the days of your life. Just as I have been with Moses, I will be with you. I will not fail you or forsake you. Be strong and courageous, for you shall give this people possession of the land which I swore to their fathers to give them. Only be strong and very courageous. Be careful to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, so that you may have success wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have success. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not tremble or be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Courage for a new start. Courage to begin again. Walt Disney said these words, Everyone falls down. Getting back up is how you learn to walk. It was Vince Lombardi, that great Packers coach, who said, It's not whether you get knocked down. You're going to get knocked down. It's whether you get up. And our good friend here in Florida, Tim Tebow, said it this way, When you get knocked down, you must keep getting back up. You must get up again and again and again and again, because knocked down you will be. Joshua, he has been by Moses' side for 40 years. They've been wandering in the wilderness. They've yet to cross the Jordan. They're not going in. And Joshua's following, and he's helping, and he's enabling, and he's fetching, and he's running, and he's administrating. I'm sure he did a lot of praying. And Moses dies. And God says to Joshua, arise, cross this Jordan. I'll be with you. I will not fail you. I will not forsake you. Joshua, be strong and courageous. And Joshua had to find courage for a new start. All of us face the times when we fall, when we fail, when a new start comes. And I want us to think about Joshua this morning and apply his start to our lives. First of all, I want you to think with me about the time when grief breaks your heart. It is time to begin again. Grief will break your heart. Notice the text. God said, Moses, my servant, is, everybody say that word, dead. Moses, my servant, is what? Dead. Moses, Joshua, is dead. And grief, no doubt, broke his heart. And when grief breaks your heart, when death enters your family circle, you must find courage to begin again, to start over again. Sometimes it's a friend. Death comes, and you must then find new friends as you begin again. Sometimes it's a leader, and when a leader dies, like Moses, you have to trust the next leader that is going to come. I've been reading this summer in my summer reading program several books. I do more reading in the summer than other times. One of those books I read, The Accidental Presidents, about the men who became president when the president died while in the Oval Office seat of the presidency. Most of us think back to Kennedy's assassination. And someone had to say to VP Johnson, take courage. I think of all of those seven that I read about. Truman, oh my. Roosevelt. He'd been president for 100 years. Seemed that way anyway. It was in his fourth term. Roosevelt died, and Truman came to Mrs. Roosevelt and said, I'm praying for you. And Eleanor said, oh no, we must pray for you. Grief at the death of a leader. Someone must take courage and step forward. Some of you know what it's like of late to step and be there when a spouse dies. And you must find courage to begin again and go on. Others, it's when your parent, when you're young, is called seemingly early in the journey, and you must find courage to begin again. The Bible says we are to walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Don't be building a building in the valley of death. Don't build your fortress and grieve for a lifetime. Walk through the stages. Hurt, anger, disbelief. But when you come out on the other side, you begin again. Psalm 31:24 says it this way to us. Be strong. Let your heart take courage, all who hope in the Lord. If you've got hope in the Lord, let your heart be strong. Take courage, my friend. Take courage. When grief breaks your heart, begin again. Begin again. Start again. You must put that foot forward. Walk again. Moses, my servant, is dead. Secondly, you must take courage when transition paralyzes your heart. Begin again. Just think for a moment. Your name's Joshua, and you're there. And as millions of people been wandering in this wilderness, eating manna for all of these years. And they can't get into new Canaan, into promised land. And finally, Moses dies. And somebody sends the message, Joshua, you're up. Now, if you think it's tough on Joshua, just think about those millions of people when the text message went out. They all got it on their stone tablet. The big guy is dead. The guy that went up on the mountain and brought the tablets, gone. The guy with the rod, threw it down, it turned into a snake, grabbed it by the tail, gone. The guy that got water out of a rock, gone. Hey, Joshua, you're up. You got a snake stick? You got any rocks you can get water out of? God written you any love letters on a stone tablet? Just imagine following that. What a transition. But transitions do come. And when those transitions paralyze your heart, it is time to begin again. Sometimes it's with a new leader. Sometimes it's a new family. Sometimes it's a new city. Sometimes it's a new job. School begins here in the morning. Do you know there are hundreds of students that will begin school tomorrow in a new city, in a new state, in a new place, and they don't know anyone? And their heart is paralyzed. My granddaughter, the youngest, the tender-hearted one, not the mean oldest, when I'm talking about the tender-hearted, she went into brand new connection class this morning. Her grandmother had been her teacher for a year, but her grandmother's not her teacher this year. And she walks in and squalls. Where is she? The transition's come. Let me tell you, it'll happen to a sixth grader and a ninth grader and, oh my, the senior students that have gone to school somewhere all their life, and tomorrow they will begin their senior year in a brand new school in a brand new place. One of the tough transitions of life, and their heart can be paralyzed if they don't learn to begin again. There are people in this room, your parent has died when you're young. Your remaining parent then later remarries and you've moved into a new house and a new home, it's transition time. Oh my. You got to find courage to begin again. For some of you, it's in a church. Some of you have moved to this city and you're thinking, I may be going to join Olive Baptist Church, but I don't know if I like this guy doing the preaching. I don't know about this singer. Who are these people that are on the staff? Who was that guy I couldn't understand baptizing today? Who was that? It's a new day in a new place. You must find courage in the transition to begin again. Mr. Village at Olive has a brand new leader. We must find courage to begin again. John Huff is on our team transitioning in college to our education role. We must find courage to begin again. And let me just say in passing, I've had so many give positive feedback about John Huff and what he's doing in the educational process at Olive Baptist Church. My goodness, what a great young leader that the Lord has brought to us. We lost a staffer this week in our IT section. He's gotten a job, moved to a greater salary and a larger venue and place. And it's a good step for him, but a bad step for us. And we're now beginning the search of looking for that new IT person. And you know somebody that's good and a servant, then we're looking. They'll come and be a part of our program, keeping all the computer stuff going. For it'll be a new day, a new time. I will never forget God teaching me about transition. I was a junior student at Pisgah High School. I'd lived all of my life wanting to play football for Sam Kinnamer and basketball for Paul Cooley. I'd watched them since I was a little boy. All the players used to come in our grocery store and I'd see those big, hairy-legged guys. I'd say, I want to be just like that one these days. They'd come wearing that red sweater with that letter on it. And I said, man, I want me one of those one of these days. And some of them had that letter on there and it had a star on it. I asked my daddy, I said, what's that star? He said, that means you're the captain of the team. I said, I want me one of those. Well, I played for Coach Cooley my junior year. I played for Sam Kinnamer my junior year at the end of school. They both retired. I entered the senior year as the captain of my football team, the captain of my basketball team. I played for Wallace Tinker. Then I played for Coach Swanick. Then I went to junior college and played for Coach Elder. At the end of my freshman year, they elected me captain of the basketball team. The next day, Coach Elder announced to us he was moving to the University of Montevallo and we'd have a new coach. Here I was 4 years in a row as a junior in high school, a senior, then a freshman in college, now a sophomore in college. Every year a new leader. Let me tell you, it takes courage when you start with a new leader. You come to a new place, it takes courage. But dear friend, you cannot allow change to paralyze you, because if you're not changing, you're in Bayview. That's a cemetery for those of you that are new around here. You're always changing. If you don't believe that, go home and take a good long look in the mirror. Amen. When nobody else is around, take your shirt off. Amen. Transitions. If you're not careful, transition will paralyze you and you just stop and say, I'm not going any farther. And you just stop and you get angry and you sulk and you get sour. And God says, hey, Joshua, take courage. Take courage. We've got yet things to do. I preached Friday night to deacons. Then Saturday morning in another place, I preached to a deacon conference. I don't know what God's trying to teach me this weekend. It's two great meetings. As I preached in those, and all of those men said, how long have you been to your church? I said, it'll be 29 years pretty quick. They said, man, how you stay 29 years? I said, you got, number one, you got to have great deacons. But I said, number two, you got to understand, you pastored a church 29 years, you've pastored three, maybe four churches. Because it changes. People live, they die, people born, they come. You cannot let that transition paralyze you. One steps out, another steps in. You must find courage. Some of you have found yourself frozen in your tracks because things have changed and you just, it's not you don't know what to do, it's that you won't do it. Be strong and courageous. Joshua, I'm not going to leave you. I'm not going to fail you. Let's go. Begin again. Begin again when grief breaks your heart. Begin again when transition paralyzes your heart. But thirdly, begin again when sin claims your heart. Why was Moses and Aaron dead and they had not entered into the promised land? Look at the Word of God in Numbers chapter 20 and verse number 12, where the Bible says, but the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, to treat me as holy in the sight of the sons of Israel. But look back before that. You have not believed me. There it is. To treat me as holy in the sight of sons of Israel. You've had a lack of faith. Therefore, you shall not bring this assembly into the land which I have given them. Moses, Aaron, you're not going in. Why? Because of unbelief. Yes, he dealt with the rock wrong, but it was a faith issue. And let me tell you, if you don't walk by faith, you'll begin to walk by sight. And when you walk by sight, you're walking in sin. God's called all of us that follow Jesus to walk and live by faith. And when sin enters your life, you must deal with it so you can go forward. If you do not, sin will claim your heart. And it will cause your heart to get hard. And you will stop. And when your heart gets hard, God doesn't speak and you don't feel and you don't sense. Man, I was in deacon's prayer this morning. I have 3 to 4 men come pray over me every Sunday morning. And this morning, thank God, there was one of our young deacons. He was weeping over this service today. He stopped. He tried to pray. He couldn't pray. And tears fled. And I thought, thank God for a heart made of flesh. That he was finding courage to step forward. Now, sin will claim your heart. It did with Moses. But I want to give you a second illustration of it. It happened with David. You got your Bible, turn over to Psalm 32. Just flip there a few pages to Psalm 32, verses 1 and 2. Now, you know Psalm 51 is about David and his sin with Bathsheba, and we know that occurred. And sin comes and in all of our lives. Sometimes we slip up, sometimes we mess up, other times we blow up. I mean, we all have issues, amen? Well, David messed up. He had committed adultery. He cried out to God, how do you deal with sin? Well, Psalm 32 helps us with that. Listen to the Word of God. How blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. How blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity and in whose spirit there is no deceit. Look at this. There's two very important words. When you sin, there's two words you need to understand. That is the word forgiven and the word covered. Now notice it right here in chapter 32, verse 1. How blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven. That word literally means to separate. Your sin has been separated. That's what the atonement does in our life. God separates us from our sin. How does he do that? With the atonement. Christ is our scapegoat, and he removes our sin as far as the east is from the west, as if God puts it on Jesus, and he takes it away, and you are separated from your sin. You are forgiven from your sin. Doesn't mean there's not consequences, but in eternal economy, We find that God separates us from our sin. Amen? We don't walk around with that all of our life. Now, if you don't deal with it, you'll walk with it all your life. But when you come to the Lord, He forgives. And then secondly, He says, it's covered. It's covered. The Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse number 8, above all, keep fervent in your love for one another, because love covers a multitude of sin. The love of Jesus, it separates us from our sin, but then it covers us. It blankets our sin. It deals with it. It takes care of your sin. How do you today begin again if you failed God? Everybody in this room that's a Christian has to deal with this. We all fail our Lord. You say, not me. You just did. You see, there's none righteous, no, not one. We all stumble and trip and fall. The question is, are you going to get up? Are you going to walk forward? Are you going to find courage to go with Joshua? Chapter 32. Now, you still got your Bible open to Psalm 32. Look at it, verse number 3. When I kept silent about my sin, my body wasted away. When you try to ignore your sin, your body wastes away. Through my groaning all day long, I just grunt and growl about, oh, no, See, God does not, verse 2 says, impute iniquity. That's the accounting term. He doesn't put that sin to your account. In whose spirit there's, you can't be deceitful. There's no deceit. You can't deny it. You can't lie about it. Verse number 4, for day and night upon your hand was heavy upon me. My vitality was drained away as the fever heat of summer. Verse number 5, I acknowledged my sin to you and my iniquity I did not hide. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. How do you deal with sin when it comes in your life? 3 things you must do. Acknowledge it. Acknowledge it, number 1. Number 2, don't try to hide it. Don't try. Friend, God sees. You can't hide it from God. You hadn't got a blanket that big. And number 3, confess it. That means you agree with God about it. I talked to a lady this week. She used to come to church here all the time. Now she's drifted away. She needs to come home, but it's hard because you get embarrassed. Dear friend, you'd rather be embarrassed down here as embarrassed up there. Don't try to deceitfully come. Just acknowledge your sin. Just say, Lord, I acknowledge. I've been away. Then secondly, don't try to hide. Don't try to run and hide. Don't try to hide. And then confess. Just confess your sin unto the Father. Now, some people think you got to confess to everybody in the world. You got to confess to the Father. Now, if you've got wrong against a brother or sister, you got to deal with that. But bring your confession before the Lord and just say, Father, forgive me. You can either be Judas or Peter. You have a choice. Judas went out and hanged himself. Peter cried out. God forgave him, raised him up, and he took courage to begin again. Liz and I were driving to that deacon conference. She spoke to all the wives of the deacons, and I spoke to the deacons. And after it was over, the director of missions came to me, and he said, well, we've made a decision. Next year, we want your wife to come back, and we'd like to ask you to drive her here. I said, well, let me check my calendar. I think I'm free. As we were driving up 231, kind of the country back way, every little town we'd go to, we'd We'd see a church, and we'd see a church, and we'd see First Baptist and Emmanuel and New Way and Emmanuel, and we'd just all these churches. And most of them had a steeple on the top of it. And on top of the steeple, on most of those steeples, there was a cross. But we saw one that had like a weather vane with a chicken on it. Liz said, "What is that?" I said, "Oh." I said, "That's the symbol of the Protestant Reformation." She said, "What?" I said, "Yeah. That's the symbol of Jesus' words to Peter before the cock crows. You will have denied me three times." That rooster is on top of that church as a reminder. Don't run and hide. When you come in confession, I will do a new thing among you. That's Peter. That's that new, that's courage to begin again. Mm-hmm. You got to step out, step up, step down, and say, "Oh God, I confess my sin unto you." You want to know why some of us, you want to know why some people don't have courage to say, "Who's my one," and have a burden? Because you know you're not right with God yourself, and you don't feel empowered and adequate to share the gospel with someone because you're not living the gospel yourself. And when we find our own heart dirty, we have to say, "I'm the one. I'm the one." Oh, yeah. Joshua, oh, my Lord. "Haven't I commanded you? Be strong and courageous!" Exclamation point. Don't tremble. Don't be dismayed. I'm with you. I'm with you. I never leave you wherever you go. Find courage to begin again. Olive, week by week, we have to begin again. And then there's a season. This church will be 125 years old. We're celebrating the third Sunday in September. I read in the history of our church this week, up in Canoe, Alabama, where this church was started, when 12 people came here, the pastor rode a mule 8 hours one way to preach in this ferry pass community, then rode the mule back 8 hours after church. And you complaining it's too cool in here. Hello? It was a new start. Then our friends down at Warrington, that campus had withered. Small, and a little group of people down there came to us and said, "Would you help us?" And We came together. Last Sunday, we had 209 people on that campus. Amen. I talked to them yesterday by text, three great military families, leaders down at NAS coming to the Warrington campus and being there, and God cements their heart, and I'm praying some of them would join that fellowship down there and be a part. I hope some of them will come here tonight and hear Veritas and join the church and then go back down there and be a part. But that church had a crossroad decision. We're going to just go and die, or are we going to do what needs to be done to live again? Churches have to do it. Families have, Christians have to do it. Some of you are sitting today at a fork in the road. And if you keep going the way you're going, you're just going to drift off away from God. When that crisis comes, your heart's going to be so hard you can't even pray. And God's called you back to the fork today to go and say, be strong and courageous and go God's way. Say, preacher, how do I do it? Well, don't hide. Acknowledge your need. Come to this altar and confess. Go to a next step table and say to someone, talk to me about that. This month, who's your one? What do we share? We share the gospel, the gospel. We share Christ Jesus our Lord. I was reading yesterday, My Utmost for His Highest, Oswald Chambers' book that his wife wrote. It was amazing. She wanted to be the secretary for the Prime Minister of England, and so she learned to take notes quickly, shorthand and all, and so she wrote down everything, and when he died, she had all of his notes, and she put together this devotional. And yesterday, Oswald Chambers, through the pen of his wife, said, do not crown your common sense the Lord of your life. Die to your common sense and come to uncommon supernatural sense and let the Spirit of God speak to you. He said, common sense is killing the church because we just act like the world. Oh, God, help us to be courageous enough to come back and say, God, not just what I think, but what you think is the way we ought to go.